Hi, how do we engage in politics as Christians? That's such a huge question and a hard question and a really relevant question. Of course, it's been relevant for a long time. And I want to share with you some thoughts and kind of convictions that I've come to myself over the last few years, and maybe it'll be helpful to you. I hope that it will. So in the last election cycle, I got an odd phone call, and by the way, this will be about 7 or 8 minutes, so not too long. And it was from an in-law who hadn't talked to me for a long time, but the purpose of the call was to find out who I was voting for in the presidential election. And more than that, he had to know about my kids, about my adult kids. So are they liberal or conservative? Those are the two choices that I was given for them. And before I could even respond, he said, well, they all went to college, so they must be liberal. Sadly, I've had a couple more phone calls like that in this election. But you know, they were doing that to Jesus too, 2,000 years ago. Who are you for? Who are you against? What label can we give you? And it was such a difficult time for the nation of Israel, right? They were oppressed by the Roman Empire. They were longing for freedom, for release, for political liberation. But Jesus didn't speak to that. And it frustrated everyone because that was the first thing, the most important thing on everyone's mind. Every time Jesus was challenged with a political question, he did something interesting. He turned the question around to make it personal. So someone asked about taxes. You know, taxation on the Jews was excessive and oppressive. Should we pay taxes? And Jesus said, give to Caesar what is Caesar's. Give to God what is God's. What about the Galileans that Pilate had killed? You know, and then it mixed their blood with their sacrifices. It was a horrific crime against the Jews. And Jesus didn't respond directly to that. He used that question instead to call them to repentance. He said, but unless you repent, you all will likewise perish. One man came to Jesus complaining that his brother wasn't dividing the inheritance fairly. And Jesus said, man, who called me to be an arbiter between you? And then he said, be on guard against all covetousness. So he always spoke to the heart of the person's real need. And their real need was much greater than an inheritance, much greater than political liberation. Jesus didn't come for that. He came to free their hearts and their souls. The religious landscape, same as the political landscape. There's so many divisions and labels, you know, the Pharisees, the Levites, the Sadducees, the Essenes, and they didn't get along with one another. Instead of taking sides, Jesus took everyone beyond the labels to see what was really at stake. Remember the story of the expert in the law, religious law, who came to Jesus asking, how can I get eternal life? And he knew the answers, right? Love God. He had all the right answers, but Jesus knew that this religious expert had no intention of loving his real neighbors. So Jesus told a story, and it's a story that we all know. A man was traveling from Jerusalem down to Jericho. Some robbers attacked him. They beat him. They took his money. They stripped his clothes, and they left him bloody and unconscious. And along came a Democrat, walked right by him. And then along came a Republican who walked right by on the other side, and along came a Libertarian or a Green Party and who turned the other cheek and walked right by. And then along came a Liberal who saw him, bound his wounds, loaded him in his truck, and took him to a fancy hotel and paid for his care. Or change the labels around, saved by the Republican, saved by the Democrat. It doesn't matter. The point is, the good guy in Jesus' story is the most despised man in their culture, a half-breed Jew, politically and religiously an outcast. Jesus asked then the religious lawyer, "So, which one of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbers?" And you know what? Shock, the religious expert got it, because he didn't say the Samaritan. That word that carried political and religious weight, the word which meant enemy. He called him by his new name, the one who had mercy. See, the label was gone. He was named by his actions, his character. But people didn't like that. They preferred labels, because once you attach a label to yourself, you're in the war, you've chosen a side, you've enlisted, the battle's on. But Jesus kept moving the battle beyond politics, beyond religion, to the battle inside our hearts. He went there every time, removing labels, changing names. The woman caught in adultery, they called her prostitute. Jesus called her forgiven. A tax collector, Matthew, who was labeled a traitor, Jesus named him disciple and friend. Lepers had to go around calling out unclean. Jesus healed them and renamed them clean. A Samaritan woman, despised and disvalued twice for her ethnicity and then for her gender, Jesus renamed worthy. He changed all our names and labels, didn't he? And you know, he never changed a Pharisee to a Sadducee, or a Herodian to a Zealot, or an Ethiopian to a Jew. He swept all of us from our native country, the kingdom of darkness, to a new country, the kingdom of light. And he gave us new names because we live in a new country and we serve a new king. I'm still learning this. I'm still learning to do politics like Jesus. No more Democrats, no more Republicans, no libertarians, no Samaritans. Only someone who sees the stricken man fallen beside the road, who stops to bind his wounds. And you know, when we do that, here's what will happen. "Who is that helping that poor man over there?" people will ask. Maybe that's what they call a neighbor, someone will say. "I think that's someone who's showing mercy," someone else will say. And finally, someone will say, "I know who that person is. That's what they call a Christian." A what? A follower of Jesus Christ. In this election and to the end of our days, let this be our one true name, the one who had mercy, a Christian.